Hello there, folks. This is Achyut Ashish. I'm from STL, Australia, and we are going to speak about a very interesting topic today. You know, that has been picking up quite some steam lately. It was there in the news media all over because of a pretty interesting project that our Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, announced around the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. I'm pretty sure you guys must have guessed about it by now. The term is fiberization. We essentially want to discuss today is what is fiberization and why is it actually becoming an imperative for a lot of governments in a lot of different places. What does fiberization actually mean and how does it actually impact us? To discuss all of this, we have today Sudipta Bhaumik. Sudipta is an IIT graduate and is pretty much an industry veteran, I would say, has been in the optical fiber and cable industry for over 22 years now and has more than 40 research publications in his name. So thank you, Sudipta. Thank you so much for joining in today.
Thanks, Achyut. Nice to have me here. And the topic we have is fiberization. This is one of the topic of my interest. So glad to discuss this topic today.
So Sudipta, I think I only spoke about, why fiberization is becoming very important for the government and national broadband networks and all those things. But I think if we look closer in a particular telecommunication company's capital expenditure plans also, we would find that, you know, fiberization forms a pretty big chunk of their network strategy, right? But everybody has a different explanation of fiberization, right? Or a different understanding of it. And for a common man, it really doesn't mean anything because, you know, at the end of the day, I just want to use internet and whatever, you know, facilitates it. So what is your definition of fiberization? How would you define it?
If you're using internet, that means we are using internet, we are making a call, whether it is a voice call or a video call, it means that we have fiber somewhere very near to you. We are making this kind of connections or sending a data or sending an information. So fiberization means connecting this telecom network many termination points with optical fiber cables. The termination points include outdoor wireless antenna or an indoor Wi-Fi hotspot or a public hotspot in airports or malls or railway stations or any enterprises like in homes and so on. So connecting all these in the telecommunication termination point by optical fiber cable is the kind of fiberization.
Right. I think that pretty much sums up fiberization. Thank you so much. But I also wanted to know, why is it actually picking up steam these days? I mean, what has actually, you know, changed in the recent times that people are speaking about fiberization? It is all over in the news media today and every government is announcing 100% fiberization as their next go-to target or something. What has actually changed in the coming days?
If we see the data consumption, this is just growing rapidly, whether it is at home or in the workplace or in the move. So disruptive events like as a current crisis that result in a significant traffic burst and adding to the ever increasing demand for data. And this increasing the video content is one of the highest among these days, and it is not the predicting to go back to the previous baseline ever. So many organizations are already declared that a significant part of the workforce will continue to work from home even after the lockdown situation is over. So the telecom networks that need to keep up with the data growth as well as adapt these sudden changes in the demand, this with economic activity now depending more than ever on this digital infrastructure, the investment in network rollout will going to be accelerated. And the number of network endpoints that will surge due to increasing the fiber to the home penetration or 5G and the Internet of Things. And all these will require high speed and low latency network creation, and which can be only possible with the deep fiberizations and the high densifications.
If I had to sum up, can we just say that, you know, fiberization is important because there is a growth in data and data consumption cannot be fulfilled unless there is a fiber network backing it. For a layman, you know, how would you explain, as in when you say, you know, it should have optical fiber cable, I mean, what is an optical fiber? What is an optical fiber cable? And I mean, I don't see any cables around me. If I have to get connected to internet, I have a Wi-Fi router at my place and my laptop connects to the Wi-Fi router, but where is the cable then? I mean, how does it actually function? Where is the data?
I'll just give an example that you have a Wi-Fi router in your home. So how the Wi-Fi router is connected, how the Wi-Fi router taking the informations or videos or information or data and it is sending to another part of the world. This is connected with an optical fiber. There must be some optical fiber is entered in your home and it is terminated near to the Wi-Fi router. Similarly, if we go across the road, there is a lot of optical cable laid. Still, you do not see this because it is most of the countries it is laid underground, just like your any other utility, like a water pipeline or a gas pipeline. Similarly, we have a telecom duct that is laid underground. Those are nothing but optical fiber cable. So what is optical fiber? Optical fiber is a, as the name suggests, is a fiber. This is a glass material, a glass optical fiber. I mean, more precisely, it contains a glass inside that, just thin as our hair. The human hair dimension is around 100 micrometer, where the diameter of an optical fiber is around 125 micrometer, and with coating it is around 200 or 250 micrometer. So this is very, very thin fiber, and it is there in a form of a cable because optical fiber cannot withstand the load for the lifespan. So it needs to be cabled. Cable means basically it is giving a protection so that it can be deployed either it's underground or aerially, or it can able to sustain different kind of climatic conditions like high temperature and low temperature conditions, or high humidity or low humidity kind of conditions. It is always form a cable where you have a branch of fibers. It's maybe one fiber to a few thousand the fiber in a one branch of a cable. So it is everywhere in and around. And if you see any outdoor antenna or indoor antenna, and always find that some fiber is connected with those antennas. And as I mentioned that if you're using any internet, if you're using any mobile phone, that means that optical fiber is within a, maybe a few hundred meters around you.
That's interesting. So actually, I picked up two things from what you said. One is, you said fiber is actually a glass, which is ultra thin, maybe thinner than a human hair, as you said. But since we cannot throw in a glass over the road, so we put it around a protective sort of a material, which you call optical fiber cable. And then we maybe put it in the ground, or we use poles to actually deploy it. So what you're saying is below the ground, behind the walls, under the sea, there are all optical fiber cables, and unless it was there, we wouldn't have been able to speak. When we did not have fiber, right? When we did not have fiber cable, what did we actually have earlier? And you know, now that we have it, why don't we have it everywhere?
See, the optical fiber technology, you can see that first commercially implemented somewhere in 1970. So before 1970, the primary methods of the long distance communication consisted of coaxial cable, which is basically a copper cable, or a microwave, the radio, the communication system, and some part it is occasionally the satellite communication.
I mean, if you have to compare, let's say, you know, microwave coaxial cables that you said, we still have microwave today.
Yes,
I mean, 4G, 5G, people keep listening about all these G's in the world, and then there are coaxial cables, and then there are satellites, and then there is optical fiber cable also. If you have to compare these technologies, right, over certain parameters, how would you compare them? I mean, which rates were, how would you compare in terms of different criteria?
So there's a three important points you have to consider here. One is that the bandwidth, that is the information carrying capacity. Second is the transmission distance, that means how far you can transmit. And third is that costing, the cost per bit. If we see all these three places, the optical fiber is far, far ahead compared to the other medium like copper and the microwave technology. But still, we have some microwave at the last mile. For example, of course, we are using mobile. We cannot directly connect optical fiber with the mobile. So we have a last mile. We have some wireless technology, like the microwave technology. But again, the antenna or the outdoor antenna or indoor antenna, indoor Wi-Fi, all are connected to the optical fiber.
So what you're saying is copper may be replaced in the times to come, but microwave and fiber would be there for sure. And microwave's limitation would be, you know, closer to the user maybe, but then, or, you know, maybe the radio antennas, but then those antennas also have to be eventually connected to fiber. Why would you say that it is disruptive, and why do you say that, you know, it would be disruptive for the times to come as well? I mean, there would be no challenge in the particular space.
So here I would like to mention top 5 points why optical fiber is becoming so much popular among all the users here. The first point I can say that, as I mentioned, that this is a optical fiber core. This is made of a very, very pure silica glass, and that transmits the optical signal near to the speed of light, that is around 70% speed of light in a vacuum. So it makes this silica glass optical fiber the medium through which fastest communication speed can be achieved. The second most important reason would be that the infinite bandwidth means the information carrying capacity. So one optical fiber carries a multiple signals of different wavelengths at the same time and in the form of light, and each representing a separate data channel. So many information can be coupled inside the optical fiber at a time. So hundreds and thousands of these optical fiber are abundant to form a optical fiber cable. So an optical fiber cable can carry a huge amount of data over a long distance, and which is not possible with the copper cable or a microwave transmission. The third point, probably you can say that this is a kind of dielectric nature of the optical fiber. So optical fiber is a glass. You know that glass is a bad conductor of electricity. So that means it is totally immune to the electromagnetic interference. So when an electrical signal transmitted through a highly conductive copper cable, that can easily be distorted by external forces of electromagnetic interference. Fourth one, I can say that the strength of the optical fiber. Although glass is perceived as a very brittle material, but when it is from an optical fiber and when it is coated by a polymer coating, the strength of optical fiber is as high as steel wire. And the last, but not the least, that optical fiber is very secure. I mean, additionally, the electromagnetic signals that is radiated to the optical fiber, it is very difficult to track. This is basically an optical signal. It is not an electrical signal. So, I mean, almost near to impossible to be intercept signal from optical fiber. So, I can highlight these five imperatives that really make this optical fiber a disruptive technology.
What are the imperatives that you see when it comes to fiberization? There has to be some checks and, some guiding factors as to, how do we say that, okay, fine, this is 70% fiber, 80% fiberization, or, even if this is actually fiberization or not, what are the imperatives that you see around fiberization?
Well, so imperative, I generally see this way, that when you're going to deploy a optical fiber network, or you can go for a deep fiberization, five things you have to keep in your mind: that how fast, how much, how far, how many, and how easy. These are five important imperatives you have to keep in mind during the designing of building a optical fiber network. So how fast means that how fast a data can transmit from one point to another point. So this is another term is known as the latency, particularly the next generation 5G. It is one of the very important characteristic of the 5G technology is the low latency, because many applications are based out of this low latency function or characteristic of this optical fiber technologies, like automobile vehicles or industrial automations, all are based on this low latency. The second is how much, means that how much data the network can carry. So it all depends on the usable spectrum or wavelength range that's supported by the network. So more operating range of wavelengths will support more technologies and multiply the data carrying capacity. The next is how far. How far means that how far the signal can be transmitted is the transmission distance. So without losing the signal, how far we can transmit the optical signal within optical fiber. The next one, I can say that how many. How many means that how many terminal points the network can handle. Or for the fiberization point of view, the optical fiber cable need to be termination friendly. As I mentioned that now we have almost all these telecommunication devices are connected to optical fiber, whether it is the outdoor antenna, is an indoor antenna, or your Wi-Fi router inside your home, or many passive and active instruments. So that means that we have to connect almost all the devices. Even in the next generation, the 5G small cells or Internet of Things, we have small devices that need to be connected. We have many termination point around to connect all the devices. So the optical fiber and the cable has to be termination friendly. That means that the fiber inside the cable can be easily accessible to connect with these many active and the passive devices. The last one I mentioned that how easily the optical fiber cable network can be installed and operate and maintained throughout the lifetime. And another way you can also tell that it has to be repair resilient.
Okay, that's very interesting. I think that was very concise, and since you gave five pointed answers, it's very easy to remember for the viewers as well, me as well. Thank you so much. Now, I come to the most important question. How do you see the world changing around an end user like me? How do you see the world changing around when the country is 100% fiberized? I mean, what are the different applications that you see might become a reality?
So almost all the establishment, whether it is a public or the private places, like residential buildings, offices, or enterprises, or factories, and all other malls, airports, all are basically connected to optical fiber. If we talk about the new technologies, the deep and dense fiberization will become a very, very basic and primary requirement in building that all the next generation, the 5G network mainly, the 5G network, and which enables all kind of new applications. Like you can say that the augmented reality or the virtual reality, the Internet of Things, the asset tracking, the smart agriculture, smart cities, energy monitoring, smart homes, remote monitoring, like all the security based cameras, the autonomous vehicles or smart grids, and many, many more applications to come. So this new technologies, particularly 5G, is going to enable many such applications. And again, the fundamental ways is the backbone, remain is the optical fiber communication.
That's a very interesting take. Thank you so much, Sudipta. I've taken a lot of time of yours. Thank you so much of, you know, insight on fiberization. Why is it important? How does it matter to us? Why is it actually a national priority for a lot of governments in a lot of countries? Thank you so much for that. I think this is just the first part of the series, and let's discuss about what goes into making an optical fiber, let's say, and what goes into enabling deep fiberization. We'll catch up with you again for the next two episodes. Thank you so much, Sudipta, for your time.
Thank you very much, Ashut. See you later.